Sir, the topic is post-mortem examination of meat animals. Previously, I have already covered about the anti-mortem inspection, and the next part in the process of meat inspection is post-mortem examination. I have already uploaded one video about the demo for post-mortem examination. You can also see that. In this topic, I am going to cover the following main aspects. First is objective, what is the importance and purpose of post-mortem inspection briefly. Then about the general principle, how to do it, what is the basic principles. Then the requirements, what are the need and different facilities required for post-mortem examination. And then the approach, that is, what are the basic approach which we should follow in the post-mortem examination. And after that, the details procedure I am going to explain for different organs and carcass, etc., and even in other species. And finally, we will discuss about the decision or judgment based on the examination findings, etc. So what is post-mortem inspection? Post-mortem inspection refers to the systematic examination of dressed carcasses and their organs in a hygienic manner immediately after slaughter. The main purpose of post-mortem examination is to detect and eliminate abnormalities or diseases, including contamination, to ensure wholesome meat for human consumption. Of course, there are little more other aspects I am going to tell in the next slide about the post-mortem inspection. The other important aspects of post-mortem inspection are checking the efficacy of slaughter and carcass dressing techniques. Here it also includes the enforcement of animal welfare aspect. So here during the post-mortem inspection, we can detect the inhuman handling or cruelty done to the animal. There can be different kind of injuries, lesions, etc., through which we can enforce the application or implementation of animal welfare aspects. And secondly, diagnosis of disease conditions for disease control purposes. So during anti-mortem inspection, I have told this is one of the important objective of meat inspection, wherein we can detect many important contagious diseases and it can be diagnosed, and then accordingly proper message should be given to the respective farms or other authorities for taking necessary care for the disease control program. Objectives of post-mortem inspection, mainly we can put it in three aspects. One is wholesome meat, second is worker welfare, and third is prevent and control disease. So through this post-mortem inspection, we can detect and eliminate abnormalities from the carcass. So any carcass, if there is any abnormality or symptoms of disease, such carcass should be eliminated, and we should ensure the supply of wholesome disease-free meat for human consumption and also to safeguard the human health. Secondly, to check the efficiency of slaughter and carcass dressing. Here I already told previous slide, to enforce the animal welfare aspect and no cruelty should be allowed. And moreover, it also checks about the working efficiency and other hygienic aspects of slaughter. Thirdly, to diagnose the disease condition for control purpose. Here it helps in identifying important diseases and gives necessary message for disease control program or for prevention. And finally, to ensure that carcasses and parts of organs marked unfit for human consumption are properly disposed of or destroyed. So any parts or carcass, if it is found to have certain objectionable aspects or disease, etc., that should be ensured that properly destroyed. General principles of post-mortem inspection. So here the first thing is the carcass. Carcass we have to thoroughly inspect in different aspects, which we are going to discuss in details. Then the visceral organs. So if an animal has any kind of disease, any one or other visceral organs will definitely have some kind of changes or signs that we have to check. Then lymph nodes, the every organs are supplied with lymph nodes. So if any organ has got any kind of abnormality or symptoms or pathological changes, definitely there will be some lesions in the lymph nodes nearby. So that we have to check. Then serous membrane, different serous membrane inside the body cavities like pleura, pericardium or peritoneum, all these surfaces will bear the symptoms of many diseases. Then we need to check the bruising, that could be mainly due to mishandling or cruelty or beating, etc., as I told earlier. Then different kind of hemorrhages may be there, we need to check. Then different kind of swelling or edema, we have to check. So this is the principles for inspection for detecting the abnormalities. General principles of postmortem inspection. Postmortem inspection involves visual perception and palpation of organs and tissues, and sometime if required we need to do incision of the organs or muscles, and also sometime the smell is important. In this inspection, examination of lymph nodes is very, very important. A meat inspector must have the knowledge of topography and normal appearance of lymph nodes in a particular animal. Lymph nodes which drain lymph from important muscles, they are called as meat lymph nodes. In pigs, it is prefemoral and popliteal. In viscera and head should be remain identifiable with carcass until the inspection is complete. This is very important. Until all the viscera and head and the carcass is examined, everything should remain identifiable. The final decision about the fitness of the carcass and offal must be given only by a qualified veterinarian. So only a qualified veterinarian is the right authority for post-mortem inspection and taking the decision. Requirements for post-mortem inspection. The first thing is the place, that is where to do this. I have discussed it many times while talking about the design and construction of slaughterhouses. So there I have mentioned in the slaughter hall, there will be a specific area for meat inspection, that is after the dressing is over. Then light, there is specific requirement I am going to tell, already I have told earlier. Then water, that is for hygienic purpose, for washing of the workers or for the washing of the carcass after the inspection, proper water facility should be there. Then some of the instruments, knives, etc. required. Stamping seal, that is after the inspection is over, we need to put seal according to the judgment or decision. So that proper seal and ink is important. Then the person who should do it. So actually the qualified veterinarian is the authority to do the inspection, or he may be assisted by some other people who are technically trained for meat inspection. And the record keeping. So all the details about the animals and their conditions, everything need to be recorded. So these are the different aspects required for postmortem inspection. Facilities for postmortem inspection, as I mentioned already, facilities for delivery of carcasses and their parts for inspection. So this is a very important requirement. In case of modern high-tech abattoir, there is conveyor system through which the visceral organs will be carried through moving top table with viscera tray in side by side with the carcass, which will move through the overhead rail. So both the carcass and the corresponding visceral organs will move and reach to the inspection place, where the meat inspectors will be ready on both sides. Depending on the number of animal, the number of inspectors should be assigned. The inspection points should have well distributed lighting, that is about 540 lux or 50 feet candle intensity, which does not distort the color of the organs. That's very important. One or two hand washing units with supply of hot and cold water, liquid soap and towels, etc. should be available in the inspection area. Continuation of facilities required. Some of the important instruments required for the meat inspectors, like knives of different size. Generally, there are specific meat inspectors' knives depending on the species. Then saw, sometime we need to cut different heavy aspects of the large animal. And then probe pH meter for checking the pH, or probe thermometer. These are some of the important instruments. Then sterilizers, facilitating complete immersion of knives, saws or cleaners. They will have either hot water or boiling water or steam. Then synchronization of rails carrying carcasses with offals for correct identification. So this I have already mentioned, the carcass and the organs should come together. And then there is a requirement or systems for recording disease data and inspection data, etc. For low slaughter rates, a manual system may be satisfactory. For fast lines or large number of slaughter, computerized systems with automatic recording may be required. Approach of post-mortem inspection. Briefly, I have mentioned earlier. So first we need to inspect the head, then we need to inspect the visceral organ, and then we need to inspect the carcass. So again, I am going to discuss the details procedure later. Here I am telling briefly about the approach of meat inspection or post-mortem inspection. So first we should do visual examination. We must observe any kind of changes in shape and size of organs or in the color. Then we should try the palpation of tissues and organs or lymph nodes. Whenever there is any doubt about any organs, we should check it by palpation. And when the doubt is more, then we can go for making incisions. That is wherever necessary. And sometime we can check the smell. By smell itself, we can find some abnormalities like abscesses or pus, etc. And finally, if there is more doubt, then we should go for laboratory test for final confirmation. So in case of head, briefly I will explain. Here we need to check the tongue, the masseter muscle and the lymph nodes. Examination of surface of tongue for FMD, stomatitis or actinobacillosis. Masseter muscle, often we may have cysticercus bovis, that is the cyst of parasite. An examination of important lymph nodes in the head area, that is retropharyngeal parotid lymph nodes for actinobacillosis. And in case of pigs, portion of muscle from tongue are examined under microscope or with trichinoscope for trichinella infection. Inspection of visceral organs. So most important is lungs and heart. I am going to discuss more details later. Then stomach, intestine and liver, then spleen, kidney, and finally uterus, udder, or sometime testis or other genital area. So briefly I will tell in a tabular form about the inspection here and later in more details. Here in tabular form, I am going to explain about the specific visceral organs, the corresponding lymph node, and some of the important disease conditions expected. First is head. Here we will see the parotid, submaxillary, and retropharyngeal lymph node. The disease conditions commonly expected is foot and mouth disease, stomatitis, rinderpest, actinomycosis, actinobacillosis, and cysticercosis. Number two, for lungs, that is commonly we should see bronchial and mediastinal lymph node, and the common diseases or conditions like pleurisy, pneumonia, tuberculosis, fasciolysis, hydatid cyst and TB, these are expected. Number three, heart, the corresponding lymph node is mediastinal lymph node, and the conditions expected are pericarditis, petechial hemorrhages, cysticercosis, hydatidosis, and flabbiness of heart. Number four, liver. The corresponding lymph node is portal and hepatic lymph node, and the conditions or disease like actinobacillosis, abscess, cysticercus bovis, cirrhosis, hydatid cysts, fasciolaceous and esophagostoma. In continuation to the previous table, number 5, esophagus, stomach and intestine, the corresponding lymph nodes are gastric and mesenteric lymph node, and the disease condition like the serous surface for tuberculosis, actinobacillosis, penetration by any foreign body. Number 6, kidney, the renal lymph node we should check, and we should check for any kind of kidney inflammation and other changes. Number 7, spleen, the splenic lymph node for tuberculosis, anthrax and hemorrhages. Number 8, uterus, iliac and renal lymph node. We can see septic metritis, evidence of recent parturition or pregnancy. Number 9 and the last one, that is udder, the lymph node is supramammary, and the conditions like abscess, septic mastitis and tuberculosis. Approach for carcass inspection, very briefly I will tell here, later we are going to discuss in more details. So we should see the cut surface, that is mostly in the muscles or bones or major nerves or spinal cord. We should check efficient bleeding, and we should check the lymph nodes for carcass. In the right side diagram, we can see the location of important lymph nodes for the carcass. At the top, there is sacral lymph nodes, then lumbar lymph nodes and intercostal lymph nodes, and in the right side, superficial inguinal, external iliac, internal iliac and renal lymph nodes. These are the important lymph nodes, or we call carcass lymph nodes, for carcass inspection. Here is few more important points for carcass inspection. The carcass should be inspected for evidence of bruising or hemorrhage or discoloration. So many times there could be change of color or hemorrhage. The carcass is split, cut surface of sternum, ribs, vertebra and spinal cord should be examined. The musculature near the shoulder joint and near the pelvis bone for detection of cyst like cysticercus bovis and cysticercus cellulosi. Then we should check the lymph nodes, as I already told, prescapular, popliteal, prefemoral, supramammary lymph nodes are also observed. Identification and record keeping. This is very important. So there should be proper identification of meat carcass. This could be with clip or tie-on labels, stick-on tickets or plastic studs, or sometimes marking inks and name marks in superficial muscles. So this is how different kind of marking options are there for proper identification and record keeping. And there should be a foolproof method must be put in place to ensure that when a carcass is condemned, all carcass parts including the head, viscera, blood and hide can also be retrieved for condemnation. So whenever there is a severe contagious disease, we should have proper system to dispose them of perfectly, including every parts of the carcass or animal. Now we will discuss in details about the post-mortem inspection procedure. As I have mentioned earlier, the approach is first is for the head, then for the visceral organs and then for the carcass. In the same order, I am going to discuss in more details. Mainly here I will discuss in respect of cattle, but many things may be similar for pig or sheep and goat also. So here about the inspection of head in cattle. Examination of outer surfaces and eyes, followed by inspection of the gums, lips and tongue for FMD, any form of stomatitis, actinobacillosis and actinomycosis. So this is the important step-by-step procedure for inspection of the head, and you can see in the right side diagram how to find the corresponding lymph nodes from the head region. Few more points about the inspection of head in cattle. incisions on the internal and external masseter muscles for the presence of cysticercus bovis. The masseter muscle is the common seat of predilection for the cysticercus bovis. Incisions of the retropharyngeal, submaxillary and parotid lymph nodes for tuberculous lesions. The tonsils of cattle and pigs frequently harbor pathogens such as tubercle bacilli, Salmonella and Yersinia. They are classified as specified risk material and must be removed and disposed of. So these are the few more points about the inspection of the head of cattle, and almost similar for other species. We are discussing about the inspection of visceral organs. Now it is about the lungs. We should do visual examination, palpation for any indication of pleurisy, pneumonia, tuberculosis, fasciolysis and hydrated cyst. So initially we should see the overall shape and size of the organ, and then by palpation we can understand the consistency or any changes. The bronchial and mediastinal lymph nodes should be viewed first. If there is any doubt, if required, then only we should incise and examine it further. The lung substance should be exposed by a long incision from the base to apex of each lungs. Whenever there is doubt, then only we should incise and check in details. In the diagram, we can see three, number 1, 2, 3. 1 and 2 are showing the bronchial lymph node, left and right. And the number 3 is the mediastinal lymph node. Now, inspection about the heart. The pericardium should be examined for any evidence of pericarditis or any hemorrhages, etc. And then the heart should be incised. Lengthwise incisions, minimum 4, from base to apex into the heart muscles, and we should observe the cut surfaces. And further details we are going to see in the next slide. Inspection of heart in continuation. Heart ventricles are incised and inner surfaces are observed for presence of petechial hemorrhages on the endocardium. In myocardium for cysticerci or hydrated cyst, in the picture we can see the presence of many cysts. A flabby condition of the myocardium is indicative of septic condition in the cow. Now inspection about liver. A visual examination is required. Palpation to check fatty changes or actinobacillosis, abscess, and some parasitic infestations such as hydrated cysts or cysticercus bovis. The portal lymph nodes and large bile duct should be incised and inspected. Gallbladder is also examined and palpated whenever necessary. Inspection of GI tract, that is gastrointestinal tract. The entire GI tract is closely observed and palpated. The serous mucosa may show the evidence of tuberculosis or actinobacillosis. In the picture, you can see the inverted the stomach portion in the left side, and in the right side, you can see much of the intestinal tract with convoluted tubes, and there will be the mesenteric lymph node which should be checked. We are going to see more in the next slide. In continuation of GI tract, anterior aspect of the reticulum may reveal the penetration and the presence of foreign body embedded in its inner side. So many times we can see foreign body which should be checked. The gastric and mesenteric lymph nodes should be routinely examined for tuberculosis, and lymph nodes we should see, that is viewing and incision of the mesenteric lymph nodes is very important to find any abnormalities in the major part of the GI tract. Inspection of kidney. Kidney and renal lymph nodes along with adrenal glands should be incised and carefully examined. Sometime we can see the nephritis, or sometime the presence of cyst, especially hydrated cyst, is possible in kidney. Then about the inspection of spleen, the surface and substance of spleen should be examined for tuberculosis, for hematoma or presence of infarcts, with visual examination and palpation. In the figure, inside this big picture, we can see the presence of enlarged spleen in case of bovine. Inspection of uterus. It should be viewed, palpated, and if necessary, incised with care, being taken to prevent contamination of the carcass. If there is any evidence of brucellosis, the uterus must not be incised or handled. In the right side diagram, we can see the detailed structure of the uterus, like uterine body, uterine horn, corpus luteum, ovary, oviduct, etc. And in the left side bottom picture, you can see the big size cyst inside the uterus. Inspection of udder. In some parts of world, udders sold as edible, so they should be carefully examined. The high incidence of mastitis makes udder objectionable as food. The supramammary lymph nodes should be incised and viewed for presence of tuberculosis and abscesses. In brucellosis infected cases, the udder is removed intact without incising them because it is highly zoonotic and risky for the handlers. So far I was discussing the details inspection about the visceral organs. Now the details inspection about the carcass. The following sections of the carcass must be inspected by a meat inspector. The cut surfaces of bones and muscles, the carcass exterior surface, the pleura, peritoneum and diaphragm. These are the things we have to thoroughly check, and further details I am going to explain in the subsequent slides. In continuation about carcass inspection, we should check the color, cleanliness and odors. The color is very important. If there is any kind of disease or abnormalities or jaundice, there will be color changes, or due to imperfect bleeding, the carcass will look very red or fiery, congested. The presence of bruising on the carcass surface and any other abnormalities we should check. If necessary, palpation and incision of affected parts may be indicated. The superficial inguinal, external and internal iliac, prepectoral and renal lymph nodes should be observed, palpated and incised if needed when the situation is more doubtful. Further continuation of carcass inspection. The carcass lymph nodes, as I mentioned previously, must be examined wherever there is a suspicion of systemic and generalized disease or presence of tuberculous lesions in the carcass. The thoracic and abdominal cavities should be inspected for inflammation, abscesses, actinobacillosis and tuberculosis. The diaphragm should be lifted as tuberculous lesions may be found hidden between the diaphragm and thoracic wall. Postmortem inspection of pigs. Postmortem examination usually is the same as carried out for bovine. So what details I have explained, most of the things will be almost similar. In case of pig, the skin should also be examined for sooty eruption, characteristic of swine erysipelas or swine fever. Tail should be examined for necrosis. Feet should be for abscess formation. Udder for mastitis or actinomycosis. In the picture, we can see different superficial lymph nodes, that is inguinal, internal and external iliac lymph nodes in a pig, and that should be viewed or palpated whenever required, incised. Pig carcass inspection. The external masseter muscles and roof of the tongue should be incised and examined for cysticercus cellulose. Trichinosis is known or suspected. Appropriate examination and muscle sampling must be carried out. If whole of the above routine examination reveals no evidence of abnormality, then the carcass is passed as fit for human consumption. Postmortem inspection for sheep and goats. Basically, the procedures will be almost similar as I have explained for bovine. In ovine and caprine, needs less detailed post-mortem inspection than other species. The carcass should be examined for satisfactory bleeding and setting. Lungs for parasitic infections, especially hydrated cysts or nematodes, we have to check. And liver for fasciolysis. So these are some of the important points related to postmortem inspection of sheep and goat. Final inspection. Carcasses and viscera having any abnormality are subjected to more thorough examination to determine whether they are suitable for human consumption. So whenever there is any doubt, to confirm, sometime we need to do thorough inspection and sometime we need to do some laboratory test to confirm. This inspection is conducted in a specially designated space for the purpose. In doubtful cases, the carcass is held pending laboratory findings in D10 meat room. So when I was discussing about the design and layout, I told there is a specific room called D10 meat room. So when there is any doubt, the samples are sent for specific laboratory test, which may take time for final result and conclusion. Till then, such carcasses will be held in the D10 meat room. Now about the last part, that is the decision of post-mortem inspection. Based on the different kind of observations and inspection and laboratory results, we can make the decision. The decisions can be categorized into four class, that is fit for consumption. When there is no doubt, no lesion, no other symptoms, then it can be thoroughly passed for human consumption. Then there is totally condemned. When there is very serious symptom of very suspicious disease which are highly risky and problematic for human health, such cases are totally condemned. Then partially condemned, when there is some part of the carcass, there is some lesions which is not very risky for human health, it is highly localized, so those part alone is removed, so that is the partially condemned. And then there is conditionally passed. There are certain conditions seen in carcass which is not very bad for human health, but there are certain issues about it, so those cases are passed with a specific condition, like some kind of parasitic cyst which is not having any much health hazard for human being for consumption. So such cases, they are instructed to cook thoroughly or sometime directed to keep in deep freezer for some days, then those cysts will be destroyed and it is quite safe to eat. And finally, there is another category, that is inferior meat. When the carcass is not very good for meat or quality of meat is not very good, then they are categorized as inferior meat. Here is few more important points for judgment. The general disposition of the carcass, its organs, state of nutrition, relevant antemortem report, and the result of laboratory tests are taken into consideration while making a final judgment. Then responsibility towards the consumer should be the uppermost in the mind of the inspector. At the same time, there must be no unnecessary wasting of valuable meat. So these are some of the consideration for making the judgment. Here is few more details for consideration of judgment. If more than 10 cysts are removed and emaciation is observed, the carcass is totally condemned. Otherwise, it is conditionally passed with instructions for proper cooking. In generalized TB, the carcass is totally condemned. An organ or part of carcass is condemned partially if the lesion is localized. Swine carcasses are also subjected to extended examination when trichinosis or TB is suspected. Carcasses showing heavy infections are totally condemned, while those with mild infections are conditionally passed, depending on the kind of disease or infection. In case of localized TB of head, it should be condemned and associated lymph nodes are to be removed. So these are some of the special conditions for making the final judgment in the meat inspection. So now we are almost at the end. The last part is disposal of condemned carcasses. This is a separate topic. I am going to discuss in details how to dispose of the condemned parts and carcasses. Here briefly a few points. The detection of unfit animals, carcasses and parts thereof and meat is followed by their immediate condemnation. The condemned products are kept secured under supervision until they are destroyed under the supervision of an inspector or sealed in containers, trucks, chutes and compartments. So all these condemned parts or carcasses are carrying the very serious disease infections, so they have to be properly disposed of, sometime by burning or incineration or sometime by burying or any other chemical methods. That is very important for public health point of view and for disease control, etc. Now we are at the end of today's lecture. I will just summarize. Today we have discussed about the post-mortem inspection. First, I discussed about what is post-mortem inspection, what is its importance, purpose, objectives, and the what is the basis of inspection, what are the requirements, what are the basic principles, what are the approaches for post-mortem inspection, and finally the details procedure for inspection of the head, the visceral organs and the carcass, and in other species. Major I have discussed in respect of bovine, but other species also almost similar. And finally about the decision, what kind of decisions to be taken and what is the basis of such decisions. So thank you for listening. Hope it is easy for you to understand and you must read from the lecture notes. Thank you.